You're watching Ryan's Tech, and this is the new Garmin Forerunner 265. And for some of you who've had other watches, it might come as a surprise that the bezel and the case material are made of plastic or fiber reinforced polymer, which is a kind of composite. Many watches these days use either aluminum or stainless steel, but not this watch. And for the price you're paying, it might throw you off a bit, but at least it directly affects the comfort level as it only weighs 47 grams. I mean, heck, it's even lighter than my Venue 2 Plus watch, which is smaller than this one. But if you can live with this kind of material, you're probably gonna love the new AMOLED display on this watch. Well, actually, I know that some people swear by the quality and usefulness of MIP displays, but I ain't one of them. And I'm sure if you use a watch with an AMOLED display for a while, you're not gonna say no to it. The watch has a diameter of 1.3 inches and 416 by 416 pixels with an always-on display that we're gonna talk about. It is also water resistant down to 50 meters of depth, so not only is it safe to take showers with it, but you can also swim with it, but probably not high-speed water sports. The straps are made of silicone and they're quite stretchy and comfortable to wear. They're also long enough for most people with an average to large size wrist of 135 to 205 millimeters. So that means that, for example, you can also wear the watch on your sleeve in winter, but of course then you'd have to use a chest strap to track your HR. And by the way, the straps on this watch are 22 millimeters. As far as charging goes, Garmin have their own proprietary charger. I think it's really time for them to add wireless charging to their watches. But for the time being, if you're like me and you don't like the awkward position of the charging plug under the watch, I found a way better solution that you might like. So just go ahead and check out the link in the description for the charger. So to sum up the look and feel, the design choice and build quality, I actually like almost everything about it. And the build quality is definitely really good, but personally I would have liked it better if it has stainless steel, and it feels like a deliberate attempt to not have to add something like an ECG app to this watch, because that feature needs some kind of metal casing to work. The other thing is that the display is just slightly curved at the very edge of it. I don't really understand why it had to be made like that, so you might have a hard time finding a proper screen protector that actually fits the watch and works properly. And I actually think that it's important to have a screen protector, depending on what you do, of course, like rock climbing and things like that, especially because they didn't improve the screen material and it is still made of Gorilla Glass 3. But before I forget, I want to talk about the buttons too, because I'm sure a lot of you are wondering if they are clicky or mushy and soft. Well, I think they're more clicky than not, but what I did immediately anyway was that I turned on the key press vibration to be sure I'm always feeling it when I'm pressing a button. And to do that, press the up button, which is the middle one on the left, then go to system and then sound and vibe to find it. There's also the option to turn on the key tones, but of course this watch doesn't have a speaker. It just uses a chip to make a sound. You may also not like the big button that says run on it, especially if you want to think of your watch as more of a smartwatch than a fitness watch. But the thing is, this Forerunner watch is ideally made for runners, literally. And in terms of comfort, like I said, it's a very lightweight watch and I've been wearing it to sleep with no problem at all. And the sleep tracking has been decent enough, but I get a bit more sleep score than I know I'm supposed to get. So a couple more things about the sleep tracking feature that you need to know is that there's something called a sleep schedule that you can set up either on the watch itself or on the companion app. This can be the same time for most people, but it also means it's great if you do shift work, because then you can schedule sleep mode for each day of the week individually. Most other watches that I know of only allow you to have one generic sleep time on your device, so this is really useful. The other thing is that you don't need to worry about the watch's display turning on at night and blinding you or waking you up, since as soon as the sleep mode is activated, turning your wrist won't actually turn on the display anymore, and you need to press either the light button or the back button to see the watch face. Not only that, but the display also dims a lot and the watch face changes to bedtime mode watch face, which is a lot simpler than the other regular ones. But you have the option to disable that and see your own watch face normally. And here's how to configure all these things about the sleep mode. Press and hold the up button, go to the system settings, then sleep mode. Here you can schedule your sleep time for each day of the week, turn off the sleep watch face, change the display brightness during sleep mode, and also turn on and off do not disturb mode during your sleep. And by the way, if you go to the display settings, you're gonna notice that there is no adaptive display brightness option. And you might think that it doesn't have that feature, but actually it's got ambient light sensor, which means it does have adaptive brightness on by default and just can't turn it off, at least right now. Now, if you press and hold the light button, you get to see the controls view. So these are all the important controls that you can also customize, including the sleep mode that I just talked about, and also do not disturb mode. So if you want to turn on the sleep mode or just do not disturb mode on demand, this is the place to do it. You can either rotate or select by touch or by using the up and down buttons and then the start button to select something. And that's the beauty of this watch. The fact that you can use both touch and physical buttons to do everything, but you still have the option to turn off the touch control either completely or during all activities, which is already the case by default, or even only for certain types of activities, for example, strength training or something else. I would, for example, disable it only when I go for a run and it's raining. Otherwise, I tend to like the touch controls enabled for everything. Glance view is probably the most important feature of the watch, where you get to see everything you need in one place. Once again, you can either swipe up or down to get there or press the up or down buttons. So for example, you can see all your sleep stats and sleep score here, plus a weekly chart of your sleep stages and your sleep score, which can be very handy. One of the things I like about most Garmin watches is that you can almost see everything you need on the watch itself without having to constantly check out the app to see what you need. Two features that are very common to see on all Garmin watches are the body battery and stress management apps. I mean, the body battery feature is just an estimate of the amount of energy you have at any moment during the day, and the amount of stress directly affects it, and that's why you see the stress levels as an overlay on top of the body battery chart. And to be honest, the body battery is something I was really skeptical about just a year ago, but these days I rely on it religiously as an important gauge, especially at the beginning of my day or any given point in time during a day. But what I don't understand here, and this is something that's been bothering me since day one I've been wearing the watch, is that for whatever reason, the stress levels are abnormally low. In fact, most of the time they're in the rest mode, which means the body battery is always very high. So I don't know if this is some kind of bug or this is in fact adaptive and I need to wear it for some more days to get a better reading of my stress level and body battery. Regardless, it's a feature I can't live without. Three important features of this watch are training status, training readiness, and HRV status. Training status uses your HRV and VO2 max to show your training load, what you should focus on, and your recovery status. Training readiness is something similar, but it takes into account other metrics like your stress and sleep too. Now, if you press the start stop button or the run button, you can see a list of all the activities you can track. And you'd be surprised to, or at least I'm surprised a little, to see that it doesn't have all the activities I have on my Venue 2 Plus, like tennis and golf. In any case, for what it's worth, I think it's still plenty of activities for most people, and you can have up to 6 data fields during your activities, and the heart rate accuracy is dead on. It's very reliable. You can even measure your running power, stride length, vertical oscillation and vertical ratio, and ground contact time. So theoretically, you don't even need to use a chest strap anymore, but what it doesn't offer is stamina and live maps, which are the things that you can get on higher end models. And here's one of my favorite features about this watch that I'm sure everybody will appreciate just as much as I do, and it's actually a simple thing. The fact that you can have so many shortcuts. That's a huge deal for me. So you can have 7 shortcuts. For example, I can set up mine to open clocks when I press and hold the start stop button, to open the HR broadcast with the back button, and so on. Just go to the settings, system, and then hotkeys to configure all these shortcuts. Battery life on this watch is really good. And in smartwatch mode, you can get up to 13 days, according to Garmin, of course. But realistically, try to aim for 9, 10, maybe 11 days. It of course doesn't have solar charging because of the AMOLED screen technology. And this is where those of you who don't like AMOLED and prefer other types of display with solar charging win a point. So who is this watch really for? Well, if you run a lot and you take it seriously and perhaps you don't want to buy a separate chest strap, this is a great watch. But it's also great for more casual users who want to have a great battery life. And it's not just for runners either. I mean, you can be a swimmer or you ride mountains and you want something that doesn't break the bank like the Enduro 2 watch and still see your HRV and training status, training readiness status. Heck, you could even only do yoga and still benefit from this watch. You can track your yoga and the screen doesn't turn off during long poses and only dims. But if you would like something a little more fashionable with amazing smartwatch features than the Forerunner 265, then go ahead and watch this video next, and you'll be surprised to hear how everyone was wrong about it, including myself.